The same rules are going to apply to our forum this evening, and I think you're acquainted with the time elements. We'll have a three-minute introduction, and we'll be allowing a three-minute close. Each question will occupy a maximum of 2 minutes, and if there is a need for a rebuttal, it's limited to 30 seconds. And that's so we can control the time element to get as many good questions in as we can. And so we're going to go ahead and begin with our opening remarks, and we'll go start with Fred.
Thank you very much. My name is Fred Churchill, candidate for sheriff of Bell County. I'm here to ask you for your vote to become the next sheriff of Bell County. And what I bring to you is 40 years of continual law enforcement experience. I've been in law enforcement all my life. This is my 40th year to be doing this. I bring you 14 years as a supervisor or manager in law enforcement. I also have over 4,600 hours of law enforcement training. Been taught through the Texas Commission on Law Enforcement. I was a police officer with the city of Harker Heights. I was a deputy sheriff under Bell County deputy sheriff under then sheriff Lester Gunn. Now, many of y'all have been around for a long time. You remember Lester Gunn, you can start to tell how long I've been in law enforcement. I retired from the Texas Parks and Wildlife as a game warden captain with nearly 30 years of law enforcement, 30 years of service to the citizens of the state of Texas, where I was a game warden captain in the Bryan College Station area and then the captain for the Austin area, which ran from San Marcos to Waco. I'm currently the chief of police at Morgan's Point Resort. I've been the chief there for the past 5 years. The department has grown over my tenure. We've brought it up to where it's very professional. The officers are very well trained, equipped, and prepared to take care of the duties and responsibilities of law enforcement in the community of Morgan's Point Resort. For any of y'all that's looking to move, if you move out to Morgan's Point Resort, it's... Okay, we're back home. It's the safest community in Bell County to live in, thanks to the teamwork that we do out there. Currently, I'm serving as president of the Central Texas Area Chiefs of Police and Sheriff's Association. I just got elected to my third term this past Friday. And what this association is, it's a 10-county area of Central Texas, with Waco being the hub. And the chiefs and sheriffs who are members of this association have elected me to be their president for the third term, their one-year terms. I also serve as vice chair on the Bell County Communications Board of Operations. The RBO board is the one that sort of runs the guides of Bell County Communications, which is the 911 center. It sort of guides the operations of the Bell County operations of the 911 center. And it comes up with helping the staff out there come up with policies, procedures, and way of doing business. As Richard brought up a while ago about the Bell County Communications Center, it's a standalone center. It takes a lot. And the fire chiefs and police chiefs of this county elected me to serve as vice chair on the committee that helps comes up with that operation. I'm a lawman. I've been in law enforcement all my life. I'm engaged in law enforcement. As you can tell, I do a lot. And I'm also on the executive board of the Texas Police Chiefs Association. So I'm Fred Churchill. I'm running for sheriff of Bell County and ask you for your vote.
Mr. Hernandez.
Hello, everybody. My name is Frank Hernandez, and I'm running for Bell County Sheriff. I want to thank all of y'all for coming out here tonight. Again, like Harry said, I know y'all are taking a lot of the time with the family. Probably could get some better places, but I guarantee you right now you've got three individuals up here that are willing and dedicated to serve you as sheriff of Bell County. I'm a Bell County native, born and raised right here in Bell County, went to school here in Temple, proud law candidate, new law cat, and Harry and I had a few classes in there together. So, but I was born and raised here, have four children, and I'm born and raised here in Bell County schools. And what I bring to this podium today to this agenda is that I have a 17 and a half years of law enforcement experience all with one agency, that's the Bell County Sheriff's Office. That shows my dedication and integrity to being with one agency all those years. I only wanted to serve Bell County, and that's what I did. I took a break, took a leave of absence to go work, and now I'm currently working for Scott and White Hospital. I'm a clinic trainer. I train the new providers and nurses to come in on the Bell County the Epic system. It's in the hospital. But I've been involved with many community service programs in Temple and Belton. Like I said, I've shared with many community services as Little League sports. I'm very active in very Little League sports and church activities. Very active in my church. And I want to come to you today to ask for your vote for Bell County Sheriff, because I feel that when you want somebody to be your sheriff, you want them to be the one that's going to go in and give that 100% every time they go in with that badge and belt on. So I want y'all to be looking forward to hearing our campaign speeches and listening to us tonight and see what y'all can bring to the table. But I guarantee you, I will serve you with full dedication and integrity and honesty.
One, two, does that sound better? All right. First off, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to thank those of you who almost 4 years ago bestowed upon me the honor of becoming the 37th sheriff of Bell County. Being sheriff has been everything I expected to be and more. But most of you don't realize, though, that I first looked at running for sheriff in 1996. I was fortunate enough to become the first Republican of the peace ever elected in this county. And in 1996, I felt that the then Democrat sheriff was possibly vulnerable in the next election. However, my timing wasn't quite right. I didn't feel it was right to my constituents to have only served one term as JP and then jump right into a sheriff's race, so I elected to wait. And by the time the next cycle came around, that Democratic sheriff became a Republican, and therefore I just had to wait until he retired. And fortunately, 4 years ago, I did become your next sheriff. Being sheriff is more than a job. It's more than a career. It's almost a passion for me. I really love almost everything I do. I have no clue. Maybe my personality is doing that. I don't know. I need to quantify the next statement just for a second. Twice in my first term, ladies and gentlemen, I've had to preside over the funerals of two fallen officers. Yeah. Deputy Adam Davis and Little River Chief Lee Dixon. Ladies and gentlemen, the hardest thing I've ever had to do in my life was to bend down on one knee and present that American flag to Adam Davis's son. Best describe it as saying, looking into the eyes of a young man with a lost soul. Fortunately, the good Lord gave me the strength to get through that without losing my composure. However, when the bagpipes started playing Amazing Grace, even I lost it. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I don't get paid near enough money to do that. But I was so honored, I would have done it for nothing. That's the way I feel about the sheriff's department. 3 years ago, we inherited a basic group of good employees. Now, we brought some in and some left. But my staff, in working in conjunction with the Commissioner's Court, have been able to provide the right equipment, the right training, and the right attitude to make the Bell County Sheriff's Department what we see today. And I know all of you noticed, because hardly a day goes by when someone outside my department doesn't say, "We appreciate what you've done, appreciate everything your guys are doing. I'm about out of time. I intend to be back for another 4 years. Thank you for your support and your vote."
We'll start this question with Mr. Hernandez. The question is, what do you see as the greatest challenge for law enforcement in Bell County?
Well, as we all know, as one of the candidates for the precinct commissioner stated, that Bell County is a county that's growing by leaps and bounds. We have people traveling, wanting to come here to live and move. And unfortunately, with good, sometimes comes bad. So we'll have some people come in, but the population grows. We're going to eventually have more crime in the area. We're going to have people to protect you and serve you, which is the sheriff's office, which is the main leading law enforcement agency in the county. So, with the county growing like that, it presents a challenge to all law enforcement personnel, no doubt. But, in case you didn't notice, you know, our law enforcement agency here in the Bell County Sheriff's Office is one of the best in the state. And we bring good officers, like Sheriff Lang said, we have good officers, we have good training, we have good people, they want to work here. So, we have to equip them and give them training and education, be able to serve citizens of Bell County. With the population growing, it's going to be tough because we do have higher crime in some areas than others, but we have to monitor that and keep it to a minimum. So with our training and education, we can do this with our deputies. We can keep them informed, we can keep them on the streets safer and more long times. That would be one of the bigger challenges that I can see with the county growing in population is to maintain that county law enforcement.
Same question.
Which way are we going?
What do you see? We're trying to do that.
Well, I deal with chiefs of police every day or every week on the problems that faces law enforcement in Bell County. If y'all don't know it, the police chiefs of Bell County meet once a month. The association that I just referred to, the Bell County Chiefs of Police and Sheriff's Association, one of the main goals of that association is networking. So that when you have major things happen, and I know all of you read the newspapers, you watch TV, you listen to the radio, and you hear what's going on around us. There's a lot going on in this country. There's a lot going on in this state, and there's a lot going on in Bell County when it comes to the law enforcement realm of serving and protecting the citizens of this county. That's why we have the opportunity where we get together and the chiefs work together so that when you have something big happen, then you can call upon your neighboring chiefs and get more resources and assets to come help you deal with it. It's important where my 40 years of law enforcement experience and my nearly 15 years of supervisory and management comes into play. As a game warden captain with the Texas Parks and Wildlife Department, I covered a 10-county area when I was in College Station. So it was crucial that we worked with other law enforcement agencies. When somebody had something big happen, that's when they called the state, because the state could bring in officers, just like the Waco deal. When y'all remember Twin Peaks and Waco happened, everything, the tragic thing that happened up there, as big as the city of Waco is, people, law enforcement, the police chiefs from Bell County sent officers to Waco. Because it was a very, very critical deal that happened, even as small as Marble Resort is. I sent officers up there to help with that. So that's the importance of having associations where you get together, you network, you help each other, and when something very bad happens, you're able to bring other people together and help serve and protect the citizens. What we need to do to plan for it, we need to do planning. We need to have, you know, strategic planning, looking at several years out in our planning, how many officers we're going to need and how much equipment we're going to need. Like Bill referred to a while ago, what it costs. Police equipment's expensive and keeping a lot of stuff is dated. You know, vests wear out and are kind of life dated. You know, the tasers are life dated. So you have to keep equipment up. So I, with my experience that I have, will be able to bring and guide the Bell County Sheriff's Office to work with the other law enforcement agencies in the county to serve and protect all of y'all.
Check again, okay. I'll take this question to mean what is a concern for our department. I'm gonna answer it basically in two ways. First off, I'm gonna somewhat agree with what Mr. Hernandez said is providing the best service, here we go again, providing the best service at the lowest cost possible to the taxpayers of Bell County. That's where my experience from coming up from basically the bottom as far as the political world goes, and in my time served as county commissioner, gave me a full understanding of how our budget system works, where our revenue comes from, and how we need to best spend our tax dollars. It's very true, our population in the last 25, 30 years has tripled, whereas our deputy force has not. But it's my experience that best enables me to work very closely with our commissioner's court to bring you, the citizens of Bell County, the best possible service we can at the cheapest cost we can, because I own property in this county also, and I don't like my taxes going up any more than any of you do. Remember what Tea Party stands for. Second thing is police in general. As you know, police reputations are, throughout the country, are coming under fire, especially from some of our media. Not so much here in Central Texas. We've got a great reputation, great rapport with our media. We've got a great support from all of our citizens. And a prime example is that is a thin blue line that actually started in Rogers, Texas, from one of my constituents down there, showing support for our local police. So I'm urging all of you, let's continue that. We have a great thing going here in Central Texas, and it's not really a challenge. We just need to keep it going, because it is a challenge in other parts of our country. Thank you.
Mr. Lane, I'd like to address this question to you. We read the newspapers and we see the increased influx of indigent and vagrant people into our county. What are positive steps that we should take to implement the care or incarceration of indigent people coming here?
Jeff, you've asked me to condense an hour program into 2 minutes. On any given day, about 30% of our jail population really does not need to be there. What I'm referring to is what I call my special people. They're there for some reason, whether it's mental, whether it's drug abuse, just some reason that they need help. And if there was help available in some other avenue, they would not be in jail. It's a continuous cycle. They get in jail, they hit meals, steady medical care, they do well, they do their time, they get out. Where are they going? Right back to where they came from, because there's nothing in place to take care of those folks. What we've been able to do here at the Sheriff's Department, we've created what's called a crisis intervention team. This is funded from a grant that we received from the 1115 Judge, the right program, a matching grant program where we're able to put this together. It is a diversion program designed to catch some of these special people before they get into the system, where they get caught in that funnel and can't get out. Today, ladies and gentlemen, that program is, what, 2.5 years old? 2 years old? Something like that. 2 years old. Sergeant Reinhardt is in the back. He is my sergeant of that unit. They have diverted 104 individuals from being caught up in the system at a great savings to the taxpayers of Bell County. And we look to increase that program in the upcoming years, hopefully at least double it to where we can save more and more lives. One at a time. That's what we're after. One person at a time. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Hernandez. Same question, yes, sir.
Well, there's not a whole lot more elaborate on that than what Sheriff Lane said, but I believe he's correct when he's saying that we have to implement that program, we have to support that program one at a time, because it's a repeating cycle, you know, it continuously happens. So we have to be monitoring that system, and we have to be monitoring the people that come in to make sure that when they do come into the system, that they're going back out and need to be productive, or they're being something other than what caused them to come back into the system. It's like being a dead horse, you know, you can only beat it so long when the system breaks. So we have to keep close contact on that, we have to keep close eye on that. So I believe that, you know, with the training programs that we have, the education that we have, starting with our deputies, like Sergeant Reinhardt, and people that are on the department, that we can continue to keep track of those people. And we can know that when the system is starting to bulge, so to say, it's starting to get where we're not on the more, then we have to kind of put our foot down somewhere and divert that somewhere else. But we also have to do that with the taxpayers' dollars also. We have to make sure that we keep that money at a minimum. Like I said in the last debate we had up here a while ago, was that we have to get the biggest bang for our buck. So we have to really keep track of this. And just make sure that the system is operating under the careful, you know, care of our team and our deputies that are monitoring this.
Thank you.
Well, taking care of these kind of people is a challenge for any government, not only on this county level, but also on the city levels. You know, our commissioner's court has done a great job of indigent health care. They fronted costs, I don't know what the number is, but I know it's quite a bit each year that it costs the taxpayers of this county, but the commissioner's court put that as a way of taking care of these type of people. But you also got to remember the citizens of this county have a right to be protected. And a lot of times when you start not doing something with that population of people, then they start coming in and doing, becoming, making the citizens become victims of crimes and stuff. So you've got to find a medium between the two. How are you going to do it? Well, it's going to take teamwork. It's going to take teamwork between all the law enforcement agencies in the county. It's going to take teamwork with the commissioner's court and all the commissioners, all the city councils of this county to come up with facilities so that we can temporarily help these people and so we can get them moved on their way to other places or help them find jobs within the community, because they do commit crimes. That's why they end up in jail. Because a lot of people, you know, in my 40 years law enforcement, I've arrested people, they'll take them away to jail. Well, I did this, so I'll get a warm place to stay and 3 meals a day. You know, I'll sit my fine out in jail. And that's what it does. It puts a burden on the taxpayers, and we're having to keep them in the jail. Recently, the Salvation Army opened up a facility in Temple. And that's some of the things we're going to have. You know, many years ago, we had Martha's Kitchen in Temple where people could go and get help. Well, that went away. That Salvation Army has come in and helping, and is working with the governments of the city and the county government to find or create facilities where we can get these people some help, get them some temporary help, not permanent, some temporary help, and then we can help them find jobs and help them move on to other places that they may be going. You know, a good thing is, you know, if you're from Austin, anybody been to Austin, Texas, and see what happens on the street corners? No, we do not need that in Bell County. And that's why it's going to take us teamwork to work together to help those people get, serve, and protect the citizens of you.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, I want to give you this question. In your opinion or view, what should be done in Bell County to stop illegal immigration or immigrants from settling here, from staying in the county? Because this is becoming a greater and greater issue all over Texas, but especially Central Texas.
Well, that's a challenging question, because back when I was born in 2007, I started getting sent to the border. You know, everybody, the media has really picked up on the border operations now. In 2007, as a game warden captain, I would sit down there and we ran border ops, what we call border ops. They'd send 100 game wardens, 250 troopers to the border to try to secure our borders. Recently, we're starting to get all the print that was not done back in 2007, and it was a heck of a lot wilder back in 2007 than what it is now. In order to do that, first of all, we've got to, this term, sanctuary cities, like Austin, Texas has been labeled with. We've got to make sure that none of our cities get labeled as sanctuary cities. We have to work with the federal government, because it is not a violation of the state law to be in this country illegally. It's a federal violation. So you have to work with the Border Patrol in order to work with them to come up with ways of identifying these people and getting the federal government to work in partnership with the federal government, such as the sheriff in Travis County is taking a lot of heat because he goes through a process of identifying these people as possibly in this country illegally. And he holds them on a hold or notifies INS that they're here, and so they can come in and make contact and see how many times they've been caught illegally, if there's other crimes they've committed, and stuff like that. And that's what it's going to take to shift Bell County, is to work with these federal agencies to identify these kind of people when they're arrested for some kind of misdemeanor crimes, and work with the Border Patrol and see if there's, we can get them picked up there, and let people realize that we do work with the federal government on identifying these people and taking action.
Immigrants are coming to the county area. As we all know, the border security thing is something that's already broken in a sense. We're catching up something that should have been stopped a long time ago. And just to still know that the statistics show that, you know, we do have a lot of illegal immigrants that do come from the south. However, statistics show that most of your illegal immigrants are from other countries. They're not from the south. So that is something that most people don't know. But regardless, they come through, and I think we've said it before here, and it's the same thing. We can't make it look so rich here, so good for them that they want to stay here, they want to settle down here. And we would love for them to come visit. We'll feed you. You know, we'll take care of you for a while. And if you're not from here, you know, and you're not going to put grassroots here, then maybe you need to move on. You know? So we can't offer the personal thing, so to say. Mm-hmm. And we got to let them know that we are welcoming, because that's what we are. We're Christians, you know, we're people who would love you. That's the people who tour here and come to the county. But you have to move on. So the border security thing is something, again, like I said, it's just this, it's a system that like Fred said that back in the early days, when they started putting that thing up, it never went through because federal programming or whatever it was. So it never was maintained. Now we got a rabbit hole defense, okay, so to say. And it's going to be hard to plug that rabbit hole now because so many are coming over, you know, in their loads from every direction now. But we do see the majority coming from the south, you know, as it shows. The media shows it, you know, and everybody says it, maybe it's bad. But we have to maintain our border security in the county. And I believe that's where a lot of our security starts, from that stuff coming from the south, immigrants, is that it starts with the county borders first. So when we strengthen that up, we can stop all of that from happening.
Thank you. Mr. Lane.
Well, most of what I'm going to say is fairly redundant to what these two gentlemen said. First off, at a county level, we have no real authority to make any rules, regulations, or anything that have to do with these immigrants coming in. What we're going to have in place, and we already have it in place, is a good cooperation with federal and other state authorities. In the central jail, we had some, I'm not going to call it extra office space, we made some office space, because part of our goals coming into our administration was we were going to improve communication and cooperation with other local, state, and federal agencies. So we made some office space available in the central jail building. We now house, we have a federal marshal that works in through there. I think we've got several state agencies, the CID from DPS offices in there, another, I think one of the Texas Rangers periodically stops in there. So we've got about four different agencies that have temporary office space in our building, which means that they cooperate very well with us, especially the federal marshals. So anything that the federal government decides to implement to stem this problem, we're going to be on the front lines. We're going to be right there with those guys that are going to be implementing that, so that we're going to have all of our agency at their beck and call. So if they need some help to help stop this problem, we're going to be there. Thank you.
Churchill, what are your views of the implementation of Lord Magistrate or the conditions around which it would be implemented?
I'm a little confused on the question. Be more magistrates for, as in magistrates who do jail duty, or magistrates as in justice of the peace, where we have justice of the peace through precincts one, two or three, like they have a temple. Question's a little confusing.
You know, that might not be a good question.
Well, there's two kinds of different. You have magistrates.
Lower magistrate.
Okay, a magistrate is a person who's appointed by the county. They are making help with. You talk about the ones that help get people through the jails and setting bonds and arraigning.
No.
Are you ones who hear the cases like Judge Duffield does?
Right.
There you go. Okay, now I know what you need. Okay, Bell County's growing. There's a tremendous caseload on the Justice of the Peace in this county. If, for those who don't know, there's two Justice of the Peace in Temple. There's Precinct 3, Place 1, Place 2. There's two Justice of the Peace in Clean, Place 1, Place 2, and Clean. But the other Justice of the Peace, Precinct 1, Judge Duffield, Precinct 2, Judge Engelking, they're the only ones. So they have a wide load of volume of stuff to handle, but they not only handle the criminal cases, traffic cases, and then civil cases too. So as the county continues to grow, and the demands on the justice courts, because the justice courts in our land are the people's court. That's where you can still go into the court, represent yourself. You don't have to hire an attorney or anything like that. You go in there and represent, you know, and plead your case to the court or to the jury. So as I see Bell County growing, in answer to your question, I think the JPs are going to have some help, because volume of work they have to do, the inquest, if you don't know it, when a person passes, you know, dies or is killed in a car wreck or act of criminal violence, a justice of the peace has to come out, perform an inquest, and make a determination of cause of death, and decide whether or not an autopsy has to be performed. So that's a lot of burden on the judges, and they're, you know, they're on call, you know, they have a schedule worked out. So definitely in answer to your question, I see Bell County needing more JPs.
Okay.
That's your, what you wanted?
Thank you. Yes, thank you very much. Mr. Hernandez?
I have to say, I do agree with that. Working as a narcotics investigator, working as a CIA investigator in Bell County, I used to be in those offices pretty frequently, trying to get warrants served or get warrants signed and stuff like that. So I see the caseload, the workload that these JPs had in the county. As Mr. Churchill said, with the, you know, they need some help. They need some help. And we've got to figure out a way to curb some of that caseload for them. The answers, probably, there's probably more than one answer for that. But bottom line is they need help. As some of the JPs that are probably in the audience tonight, they're out there in office, they probably say they don't get paid near enough to do some of that caseload that they've got. It is a challenging job, but they have a challenging job just as we do as law enforcement agency. But we have to work together hand in hand. And bottom line is that they do need to figure out a way to balance the loads and out for those JPs that are working hard for us, the county, and the citizens of Bell County.
Thank you. Just need to explain some of the legalities behind magistration. If you're charged with a misdemeanor in the state of Texas, there are some time deadlines on your magistration. It's 24 hours. If you're charged with a felony, we have 48 hours to get you magistrated. Now, that time starts running from the time that officer says, I'm 1095, which means I have someone in custody. That's when the time starts, not when they get in jail, not when they get booked in. Each JP, well, let me back up just a second. The Commissioner's Court many years ago saw this as a problem, and it still is a problem today. We spent a lot of money on video magistration. Each JP has the capability of doing video magistration through all of their computers at any time, anywhere. Most of the JPs, for whatever reason, have elected not to use that equipment that we purchased, and that's their prerogative. It's totally up to them how they want to magistrate their prisoners, their inmates. It has caused a problem at our jail. There have been numerous instances that time is running and we just can't get hold of a JP, or especially in a felony case where the district attorney's office has requested further information and the officer has to go back and do some further digging before we can actually get the case screened. It becomes a problem. And the law states that if we do not get them magistrated in time, we don't lose the case by any means, but we have to let them out on a PR bond. Now, folks, I don't want to let a murderer go because the time ran out. We haven't done it yet, and we're not going to. We're doing everything we can, but the possibility exists, and it is a problem, and we are still working on working very closely with the Commissioner's Court to see if we can address this problem. Thank you. Is getting by us really, really quick, and you've answered just through your the answers that you've given. You've answered about half of the questions that I really wanted to ask, and I appreciate the detail and the knowledge that you bring to this candidacy. But because of the limited time, I would like to ask you a few yes or no questions. Is that all right?
Yes.
All right. Mr. Hernandez, do you believe in the sanctity of human life?
Yes, I do.
Mr. Churchill?
Yes.
And yes.
I would like to ask your view of DOMA, which is Defense of Marriage Act, that was overwhelmingly passed by the state of Texas, and especially in Bell County. Nearly 70% of our population believes that marriage is between one man and one woman. Do you hold this position, Mr. Lamb?
Yes.
Mr. Hernandez?
Yes.
Mr. Churchill?
Yes.
I'm going to give you two words, and I want you to do is give me the first word that comes to your mind. Just one word. Mr. Lane, Sharia law. One word. How about garbage?
That's one word that I would, how about, I'll just agree with garbage, all right, we go with that.
How about you, sir?
I ditto.
You go and let me answer.
Darius.
Yeah, that's good, Mr. Churchill. Okay, all right. Okay, that's all I have time for. This time, we would like to introduce our forum, which actually represents both Precinct 1 and Precinct 3 of the County Commissioner race. And as I call your name, please stand, hold your applause till all five are introduced. Bill Schumann, Harry Macy, Rush Miss Schneider, Mr. Moon, Mr. Cortez. Please be seated. The rules for our forum are always very simple and straightforward. Each candidate will be given a 3-minute opportunity to open the forum with a speech, introductory speech, and close with a 3-minute speech. Each question will be asked to each candidate, and you will have a 2-minute time limit in which to respond. That does not mean you're required to take up the 2 minutes, but you're limited to 2 minutes in your response. If there is a rebuttal or a need to reply to someone that has spoken, after you have been recognized by the moderator, then you will be given a 30-second opportunity to respond to that particular statement if it's an error or if you would be contrary to it. We will time you by using time cards. When your time is up to 15 seconds, it's a warning, a caution light, yellow. And then when you see the red card, last word, that means that my button is on the trap door right under your chair. we appreciate your compliance with these time constraints so we can get as many questions in as possible. So tonight, let's go ahead and begin with the 3-minute introductory. Bill Schumann, go ahead and start.
Good evening, and thank you all for coming tonight, and thank you Tea Party for doing this for us candidates. My name is Bill Schumann, and I am currently the Precinct 3 Commissioner for Bell County seeking re-election. I had the opportunity to run for this office a few years ago when the incumbent decided to run for another office and decided that it was an opportunity that I couldn't pass up to serve the community. My experience was such that I'm uniquely qualified to be a county commissioner because of what a county commissioner does. I've got 29 years experience managing a large workforce, multi-million dollar payrolls, multi-million dollar capital projects, energy, and rolling stock, along with budgeting all of those functions. If you look at what a county commissioner does, that is exactly what a county commissioner does. And so I have the background, the expertise, and the knowledge to be able to do those things for Bell County. So as we progress tonight, please keep that in mind. Appreciate it very much. Thank you.
Harry Macy.
Thank you, Jeff. My name is Harry Macy III. I am a candidate for Bell County Commissioner Precinct 3. I'm a third generation Bell County resident, and I've been here with all of the Temple school system, Temple Junior College, now Temple College, and graduated from Mary Hart Baker with a degree in finance and economics. Married my wife, Debbie, we've been married for 32 years now, going on 33. We've got three children, all of which graduated from Bell County High Schools and went off to college. One graduated from Mary Hart Baker, two from Texas A&M and College Station. We've got six grandkids that all live here in Bell County with us, and my wife and I are co-owners of Perry Office Plus, have been since 1994. I'm sure you guys are aware of this, so it's no surprise to hear that Bell County continues to grow at a very rapid pace. Between 1990 and 2000, I think the census shows that we grew at a rate faster than 24%. Between 2010, it's 30% plus. So we continue to grow rapidly. Of course, that's a great thing, but it also brings some challenges. Great in the fact that it brings folks to Bell County, which raises our tax base when they come in and they invest in the community in houses. They invest their dollars through buying goods and generate sales tax. Of course, that's what the county survives on, is the tax revenue from property and through sales tax, and that represents about 72% of the general budget. On the expense side, though, you've got some folks that don't necessarily like to play by the rules. So, of course, that cost increases on the side for the sheriff's department, for the courts, and the jail system, which represents about 50% of the expenses the county has. So, you know, we need to make sure as a county embrace the economic development of the county, so we need to grow our tax base and we keep our taxes low, because once again, this population comes in, they got to work somewhere, they need to have a place to lay their head at night, a place they can go out and eat and enjoy themselves on the weekend. So I've served this community over the last 20 years. We've been here. I am immediate past chair of the Temple Chamber, past president of the Temple Business League, current president of the Temple Industrial Foundation. On the Central, the Texas A&M Central Texas, Regional President's Advisory Council over at Killeen with Dr. Lugliazzo of A&M, and served on the Texas Christian School School Board, was president of that, and past president of the Temple Royal Museum. So, as you can see, I enjoy serving. This county commission step was just made sense to move this direction because I enjoy serving this community. So, you know, I certainly support the things that I believe in. I believe in strong schools. I believe education is very important. I believe in safe communities. I think the Sheriff's Department does a good job taking care of our folks. I think the rural infrastructure we have has to be maintained so we can get folks to and from town. I certainly believe that when somebody shakes your hand wishing the eye, it means something. I believe in the Second Amendment. I believe that life begins at conception. And I believe that God created the world, and I believe I'm out of time. So Harry Mason, you guys, Precinct 3. Thank you very much.
I've been born and raised in Bell County. I graduated from Texas A&M University in 1983. I was married in 1980. I've been married for 35 years to my lovely wife, Joy. She's kind of my rock. I worked for a company here local in Bell County for about 12, 13 years. In 1997, I started my own business, small business in Belton, Texas. In a grading business, construction type business. We enjoy Bell County. We enjoy Temple, Texas. We enjoy Belton. I was voted in 2003 Small Businessman of the Year by the Temple Chamber. I've served on the Chamber. I've served at the Temple Economic Development. I've been on City Council there at Temple. It may be 12 years. Two of those last years have been Mayor Pro Tem. I believe I have the tools to be County Commissioner. I'm honored to be standing with these gentlemen up here. I respect each and every one of them. They've done a great job. I think our commissioners have done a great job. Our sheriff's department's done a great job. I just like to be part of a winning team. So I joined and signed up, and we'll see what happens in a couple weeks. In closing, I would like to be like one of my heroes, my hero, my father-in-law, a man who loves the Lord, a man who has integrity, and a man who loves to serve others and not expecting anything in return. So with that, Russell Snyder, Bell County Commissioner, Precinct 1.
on the Little River Academy City Council there for a while. That's where I started to do things like this. I enjoyed it. One of my greatest things is being able to talk to people and try to understand their problems and let them know my problems as well. That's what I want to do in this office. I've already gotten off track. My wife says I rambled, so I rambled. So, let's get back to being on track. My wife, Deborah, I've been married to her for 28 years. We have three kids. Three of them are in College Station. Two of them are going to Texas A&M. One of them going to Lynn College. So, money's going everywhere. Anyways, I'm retired. I worked for Texas A&M University Systems for 30 years. I retired 3 years ago. This is the first opportunity that I've had to run for office. So I'm taking advantage of that. While I was working for Texas A&M, I was in charge of new construction. I was in charge of building maintenance, fleet management, and also safety officer here in town. And it follows in line with the description for county commissioner. Budgets, it's all the same. Texas A&M is a state-funded school. Government is pretty much the same for Bell County. The budgets are going to be the same. The monies are going to pretty much come from the same places. As long as we can keep in line with those, it'll be okay. I hate being the you're the very last, so I'm sorry for you. The commissioners have done a great job. They've kept our taxes low. We have the lowest tax base in five or six counties around here, 45 cents, so that's not too bad. Everybody else is a lot further along than we are as far as taxes, and there are a lot more counties than we are. They've done a good job. I cannot complain about that. I just think it's my turn. I'd like to be able to do this for the county. I don't want to be in there forever. I'd like to do a few terms and go on about my business, let someone else do this. That's one of my goals. I appreciate your vote. I live over in Holland. I keep my phone on me all the time, except my wife has it right now, so it doesn't ring. Everybody on this board, right here on this table, they're here for a reason. They want to help. They want to serve. I want to serve. So if you decide whichever candidate here that suits your best needs, then vote for them. At least get out and vote. That's the main thing. So I have a Facebook page. My wife set out some deals, all the deals. So on my Facebook page, I have my thoughts, what I think. They're not promises. There are things that I think of and the things that I want to, things that I believe in. Last word? No, you have the last word, Richard. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Richard Cortez from Little River, Texas, and I too want to thank the Tea Party and all of you folks for being out here tonight. It is important to be a part of the political process. I grew up in Little River, went to Academy Schools, and Temple Junior College, same time back there. And after I got my grades that first year, Uncle Sam sent me a letter, said meet me at the bus station, and I said, well, I'm going to join the Air Force. And I spent 4 years in the Air Force. While I was in high school, you know, I ran track, ran the mile. And I kind of feel like I'm fixing to take off here, you know. But anyway, it's really good to be a part of Friends here in this room today. When I first ran for office in 1992, I ran on fiscal responsibility. You know, I think, what does that mean? Well, fiscal responsibility to me is being effective use of taxpayers' monies and to use it wisely. As has been said, we have one of the lowest tax rates in the region. And we don't have that strong a tax base, but when you look at counties like Williamson County, which is just south of us, Williamson County has almost four times the tax base and a higher tax rate. And so when you look at that, you say, how many dollars are you taking out of someone's pocket for their home? We take out less than one-third of the same number of dollars out of a person's home compared to like Williamson County. that's the part of it. We use your money wisely. What does the county commissioner do? One of the things that we do is prepare a budget, but then you have to manage that budget. You know, you have a sheriff, you have a clerks, you have judges. Those folks in Bell County are elected by the citizens, so they don't work for the commissioner's court. We work with those folks. We get learned and educate ourselves to the rules and the duties that they have in their office so that we can figure out what their budget needs to be along with them. I served for the last about 15 years as chairman of the State Education Committee for county commissioners across the state of Texas. So education is very important to us. We go to conferences to learn about what other offices are doing. We meet with our folks. Ladies and gentlemen, we don't sue each other in Bell County, but they do in other counties all the time. This elected officer is suing the commissioner's court. We work hard to create a collaboration. Of all the projects that we've done over the last 20 plus years, the one I think is the most valuable to you is our project we have with the 911 communication center. We actually had a trunked radio system where our police, fire, volunteer firemen, everybody talks on the same radio system. We did that before 9/11, in 1998. We have one ESAP in Bell County. And we'll talk some more about that in the past. I'm Richard Cortez, and I look forward to working for you in the next 4 years.
Thank you, gentlemen. We'll begin this question with Mr. Harry Macy. What is your definition of conservative or conservatism? What is your definition of being a conservative?
Thank you, Jeff. I appreciate you picking me first. It's a great question. It's one of those things where, there was a preacher one time that said, I don't know how you define pornography, but I know when I see it. I think conservatism is the one that you see the results in the aftermath and you say, gosh, they've done a pretty good job keeping things in line. Like Richard mentioned, keeping the dollars that they told me to talk about the tax rate here in Bell County. To me, I think it's doing the most that you can with the dollars you've got. Because it's real easy as a government entity to go out there and say, let's just raise the tax rate, we'll just get some more money. But when you see folks like the Bell County Commissioners who've done a pretty good job over the years, say, you know what, we need to be responsible for the voters that put us in this office. We need to be good stewards of the dollars they give us and use them in the best manner we can. So, I'm not sure that's exactly the definition, but I'm pretty sure that's what I think it is.
Well, thank you. Thank you.
Hey, Frank, we're going to have a little trouble hearing with the mic. Can you ask him to slow down a little bit?
Hold it close to your left.
Harry, what he said, on your left. They're saying you're holding the mic too far and they can't quite pick up what you're saying. So please repeat that. No, I'm kidding.
Thank you. Taxpayers' money is like your personal money. It's real money. It's not monopoly money. We all work under budgets. All of our families work under budgets. Our kids, we try to work under budgets with our kids. And it's real money. And if you don't have it to spend, you don't spend it. If you need to cut your budget, you need to cut your budget. Probably can see some of my voting records in Temple Lab. There's some things that I didn't vote for to add this and add that. It's because we didn't have it. And we work on a balanced budget, and we need to conserve all the funds we have. And if there's some left over at the end of the day, then we'll look at the capital expenditures and use that money in different ways. Let's don't spend the money before we get it. It's real money. It's not monopoly.
Mr. Moon, same question.
One of the things, I didn't go by the list, sorry. I'm retired from Dixie Indian, but now I'm farming ranch. That's one of the hardest things you can do and be successful at unless you are conservative. Input cost, your output cost. You can't control your output cost. The only thing you can do is control your input cost. So, to be conservative, is if I can't afford to do this now, then I'm going to wait. I'm going to use my money to things that I absolutely have to have. Or I won't make it be here next year. It's pretty that simple. You use the money that you can. If you don't have to use it, don't. You regulate your budgets. They're already set. So you're going to maintain that budget all down through the time. But when you're going through your budget committee meetings and figuring out what you're going to need for the fall or the next year, that's where you set what you need. You'll know then the monies you're going to have and that you can use. So a lot of the conservatism goes back to farming and ranching. Same thing with this entire county is based on farming and ranching, used to be. But you spend the money that you have to spend, you conserve the rest of it. And that's why they have a surplus. It's because they do conserve. They've done a good job.
Well, I've already told you I felt an effective and wise use of your money is fiscal responsibility. But I think conservatism is much more than just dealing with money. Conservatism is how much government imposes its desires on the public. And I think that my idea of conservatism is that the county, state, or the federal government doesn't need to impose things on us that they don't need to be doing. And I just say it's a much broader topic than just money. And money is important. That's what we need to be important. That's part of our process. But I think it's a broad-based view of what we do.
Can I back up just a minute?
Sure.
I've been married to my wife for almost 45 years, which makes me the senior guy out there, and it's the same woman for all 45 years. I think everybody has given a good definition of conservatism, wanting to keep the government out of our business. But I think if I could ask you to do one thing and hold a thought, so many of what you hear your politicians talk about when they're giving you these pep talks is, you know, I'm going to watch the budget, I'm going to do this, I'm going to see where we're going, and if we're going too fast, I want to slow down. A true person that is conservative is not only looking forward, okay, but they're also taking a look back at them to see what has been done in the past that may not have been best practices or may not be as efficient as it should be. I think if you'll go back and look at the 3 years since I've been on the court, we have done things that have saved the county significant amounts of money without adversely affecting any of the state-mandated county operations. The sheriff has not suffered because of the savings that we've incurred. None of the court systems have suffered because of the savings that we've incurred. And again, it's because we go back and we look at what's being done before that we're able to generate these savings. Thank you.
This question will be directed toward Mr. Schneider. In view of the county debt or the debt indebtedness of Bell County, which I believe you can correct me if I'm wrong, is in excess of $170 million. Yet we are entertaining the idea of having a bond for the expansion of the Expo Center. And my question to you as commissioners, and in reflection of what you've already discussed as conservatism, the question to you is it wise for us as a county to look into further indebtedness before we actually take care of the debt that we already have?
I think that's a long question. You said I can't tackle that. Unfortunately, in government, cities, counties, we incur debt. We need infrastructure. We need to have the money up front for folks to come to Bell County. So we incur debt. As far as expansion at the Expo Center, I believe the hotel motel tax is going to be earmarked for that expansion. From what I've been also told is that that should help the deficit at the Expo Center, the Equestrian Center, should be able to attract more people, attract more business to their local vendors, our hotels and our stores. Debt, we've looked at in the previous years is that there's debt that always rolls off, and we encourage using that first and not encourage additional debt, and try to still keep the taxes at the same, not lower. I think this past year in Temple, we passed a bond for Parks Bond. It was a 5-cent bond, and we ended up doing that with a 4.5 cent. So actually, and that was voted on, a 5-cent increase. So we actually went down a 0.5 cent. We added 4.5 cents to make it 5. So it's unfortunate we have debt. I think we need to maintain it. I think we need to watch it. I know that our Director of Finance works real close with the council and with debt. We're very, very careful not to go out too far. We actually look at our rates often, and a lot of times we'll get refinanced and save money there too. So it's unfortunate we have debt. We live within our bounds and try to make what we have with best we go.
I was at the Expo Center during the fair 2 years ago, I believe. My daughter was showing animals there. Two of the commissioners came in, and they were talking about the hotel motel tax, and it was going to be, they wanted everybody to vote for it. It was going to be designated for this building. That, I don't believe, happened. I believe it was earmarked for something else, for maintenance, if I'm not mistaken. At this time, I don't believe they need that building, and should be. The debt service that they have now should be taken care of before they build this new building.
Well, our debt is a little over $100 million, but I think if you look at any of our bond council, we'll tell you that we have less than right at 1% of your debt to tax valuation, which is very low. And so we're in very good shape. We have a very aggressive debt retirement program. We are paying off debt at a very rapid rate. We have a high principal payoff. So we're moving forward with that. The money is already borrowed to build an expansion on the Expo Center. Now, let me tell you, the hotel motel tax is a revenue tax. And we've told almost everybody that we've talked to, I have, that when you borrow bonds, you borrow bonds as a tax debt. If you do it as a revenue bond, then that's a great deal more risky and it causes the interest rate to be a great deal higher. So the idea behind it is to use that money that's debt that's allocated right now to run the Expo Center as debt retirement. Because our debt retirement is about 9 cents on the income tax rate. That doesn't change. When we've borrowed money in the last few years, we have not changed that very much. Slightly, but not very much. So what the idea is, you take that hotel-motel tax revenue, which is a revenue source, not a tax source, and it pays for the operating expenses of the Expo. And then you take that money that was used for operating expenses, and we'll be able to use that for debt retirement. It'll be good in the long run. The Expo Center, if we don't expand it, is not going to be able to function with the services and the kind of events that come out there now. It's too small. And so we're using the Expo Center dome for events that hold 500 people, but that's where you have the cutting horse shows, a lot of shows. Efficiency and effective and wise use of your money to say, put it in another facility where the seats are like 1,000 seats. That's what we're proposing to build, a 1,000-seat arena. It'll be, we've already got a pretty good idea that we've got the opportunity to bring in the state Burford show and several other state livestock shows, which will generate a great deal of money in our local business downtown. So that's pretty much where I am. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm the general ag superintendent for the youth fair. We'll be out there all next week. And I can promise you, Eddie and John Fisher are here. The kids that are out there at that livestock show are not the kids and the people that you see on the Wheel of Justice on Tuesday nights on Channel 10, okay? Those kids are learning valuable life lessons, and it's worth the investment that we made in those kids. Now, as far as the debt, I actually have a copy of the county debt service. My wife has got it if anybody wants to see it. We were able to borrow the money for that expo without raising your tax rate, okay? Mr. Snyder just said that they had to borrow money for parks and increase your tax rate by 4.5 cents. Bell County did it and did not raise your tax. The amount of taxes that are going to pay off that have not changed. Like Richard said, the amount of the tax that goes to pay off debt has not changed. That's because of good fiscal management, and it's because the county is positioned and was positioned when we went to borrow that money to be able to do it. Hotel tax. Probably the most discussed and misunderstood event that's taken place in Bell County in my 3 years as here. The hotel tax was actually passed in 1987. The state legislature said counties could impose up to 2% tax, but it was a county option. We opted to do that, and it reduces the operating expense of the expo. It was not earmarked to pay for any kind of expansion, but to offset operating expense. Thank you. Mr. Mason.
I understand the question correctly was, should we be issuing bonds when we still have debt? I think that's why I understand the question. So,
that's true. Should we incur more debt in lieu of the debt we already
have? We've got debt. And unfortunately, debt is just kind of part of life. For anybody that borrowed money on a house, or borrowed money on a car, or borrowed money to send your kids off to college, unfortunately, it's just kind of part of the things that we look at, or a business for that matter. The thing to look at, in my opinion, is you look at your ability to service that debt. And I think we've talked about it a little bit here. That is, we've got a low tax rate. We didn't change the amount of dollars in our tax rate that are going towards it. So I think Richard said about 9 cents. So that's pretty incredible. And once again, it's a testament of what a strong county can do. If we look at the economic condition of Bell County, we're very strong. So to me, it certainly made a lot of sense to say, what is this going to change our picture out here financially? Can we afford to service the debt that's coming out here? Because the debt that we're looking to issue the bonds for certainly makes sense as it's an economic development tool for this county. As Mr. Schumann said, the kids are out there, they're learning life lessons. I think somebody mentioned up here, we've got folks coming into town that are spending money in all places, so I think it makes perfect sense to do that. Now, I hate debt, but unfortunately, sometimes you've got to borrow money, sometimes you have to service debt, and I think the county's done a pretty good job saying, how much can we borrow, how much can we service? And it's a great thing that the tax base in Bell County is growing because the tax rate stays the same and you have more dollars coming in. So that to me is what it's all about, is having the dollars to service that debt and do it in a wise manner. Thank you.
Thank you.